So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We are happy to have here Professor Matteo Negri from the University of Pavia as a speaker today. So, Matteo's area of research is continuum mechanics, mathematical continuum mechanics, in particular elasticity and phenomena beyond elasticity, rate-independent problems, fracture mechanics. And I think you'll tell us something about this research today. Thank you
Okay,
very much.
thanks a lot. Of course, I'm very happy to be here. I really have to thank a lot, Martin, for the invitation here. Okay, what I will talk today is somehow the last result, but in a series of papers. They started with the work with Giorgio Tecnesi and then Stefano Albi and Masato Kumura also. And some of the results that you will see here are developed with my PhD student. Oops, she's not going there. For some reason, let me check. No. No. Ah, okay, perfect, perfect. Everything is working. Okay, so I decided to start with not a problem, an example. It is a bit silly, maybe, but it is to give you the idea of the kind of system and and a particular feature of the system. Okay, so I think that you are just pushing this block of wood with the finger. And then this is rigid, okay? So all the energy is just the energy given by the position of the barycenter, just because it is rigid, okay? And since I am pushing, now you see I'm pushing this way, so equilibrium here is given with an inequality for the derivative of the energy. This is because I am pushing, so my finger is working as a constraint also. And so basically, if you think that this point here corresponds here, I'm sorry, it is a bit hard to this point here. So this is the position of the barycenter of the block of wood, and this is basically the trajectory that it will do. Okay, so I am starting like this, and then I push, and you see, of course, this is changing. So remember that basically the trajectory and the energy somehow they have the same behavior because it is going up a bit. So in energy, it is growing. And of course, you go on until you reach this. And then, of course, what happens is that you just push a little bit and it will fall. Okay, it is very, very simple. But it is really an illustration of the two kinds of regimes that we will see later. So when I am in this part of the evolution is steady and very slow, in the sense that if you stop pushing, then there will be no motion, the system will be in equilibrium. But instead, along this part of the evolution, we could say that it is, say, unsteady in the sense that from the pure point of view of the potential energy, okay, we don't have this inequality, no increase in energy, but decrease in energy, of course, until you get here to the global minimizer, which is this value here. Okay, so that's very simple. Of course, you have dynamics in between, but in the kind of model that I am using, there will be no dynamics. So basically, it will be just a play with equilibrium configuration. This is because basically most of the schemes which are used today in phase field fractures, they are basically using only statics, so they are quasi-static evolutions. Okay, so now let me go to the phase field setting. Here will be a little bit, of course, more precise. Now, the kind of energy that I am using is made of two parts. The first part is the elastic energy. So U is the displacement field and V is the phase field functions, which takes values in between 0 and 1. Okay? So the elastic energy, of course, is the integral over the domain. The domain is 2D for technical reason. I'm sorry, I made a mistake here. Okay, fine. And the energy takes this form here. So the first thing to do is to split the strain into volumetric and deviatoric part. This is an orthogonal splitting. And then we rewrite the elastic energy in terms of this split of the energy, taking into account positive and negative part of the volumetric. So we have to keep in mind the following. So positive volumetric is somehow a displacement of this type, and the negative volumetric is instead a compression. So positive is traction, negative compression, and then deviatoric is some sliding like this. Okay, so this is the idea. So what you can expect is that when you have compression, there should be no fracture and no dissipation. And this is why basically there is no the phase speed function V, which is multiplying this term, but only these two. And then I will show you in the next slide what is the effect in terms of fracture. Okay, now as far as the dissipated energy instead, so this is somehow well known if you use phase field methods. That for fracture, that if you want to approximate the length of the crack, this is this term here, then you have to use this kind of energies, which have two parts, lower order and higher order, which are scaled in this way by this value epsilon, which is called the internal length of the model. Now, the energy that I'm using here is what is called the brittle energy. And says that basically dissipation is proportional to the length of the crack, and the constant here of proportionality here is a material constant. It is called toughness. Okay. Now, actually, this is the energy which is dissipated, and we will see a little bit later. But when we think in terms of dissipation, so the derivative of the energy, I think that things becomes a little bit more clear, in the sense that if you take the derivative of this energy and write down the dissipation. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm continuously making this mistake. You see, of course, that you get this term, but you see that this is valid only when V dot is negative, while with the plus infinity otherwise. Why? Well, the point is that fracture is irreversible. V equal to 1 correspond to no fracture, V equal to 0 correspond to fracture. And indeed, you see that the crack set is corresponding to the set where V is equal to zero. So irreversibility of the model is easily is modeled, sorry for the terms, with monotonicity of the function V. Okay, so the function V has to be monotone in time in a way that we cannot go back because it will be a reversible process, which is not. Okay, now, as I was telling you, the length of the crack is represented by this guy, and the set of crack is basically represented by the set where V is equal to zero. Now, there is one point here about the relationship between monotonicity, so this constraint, and the energy here. Now, if you think of monotonicity in these terms, then you should also expect that in time, the amount of energy which is dissipated should be increasing, okay? It cannot sort of decrease. The point is that the energy, this functional L here, is not really monotone with respect to V because of the presence of this gradient here. Okay, so when V is decreasing, the distance from one is increasing. So this first term is monotone with respect to V, fine. But then you don't know anything about the gradient. So it could be that when you decrease the function V, you always say you optimize with respect to the gradient, and then the energy could decrease. This is maybe what happens. You can think of it when you have something like this, for instance. Okay, here there is a lot of gradient of V here, and then in the next configuration, it is lower. You get this one, so the energy will be decreasing. So we have to take all this into account. We will do it in the evolution. We will see that actually it works. Okay, so what is behind all of this? Well, this kind of energy is used because it's a very convenient energy in the sense that there are no geometrical unknowns. And behind all of this is, say, gamma convergence, typically as the mathematical way of justifying the use of this energy. Indeed, when this parameter here, the internal length, vanishes and goes to zero, we recover what is called the sharp crack limit, where you see that we have an elastic energy here. It is exactly the elastic energy that is basically this splitting, but it is just a way to write the linearized elasticity times this guy, which is the constant times the length of the crack set. So in this convergence, this term here, L, is what is converging to this, and this term, of course, is converging to this. But then there is a very important point. Now, it is the following. why the split here was used in this way, so in a way that there is a function d only on this side and not only on the other side. So basically, you have to think of the following. If this energy is very large, then you can think of reducing the function d in a way that you lower the energy. Okay? This game is not possible here on the minus the volumetric part. The effect of this is to model non-incompenetration on the crack set, basically. So with this kind of split, you recover in the limit a model in which the displacement has this important property. So on the crack set, there is no way to compenetrate. So it can only slide or open. Okay? So this is usually for this reason. Now, what we know when we have gamma convergence is that we have convergence of global minimizers of the energy. If we have compactness, I'm sorry, again. But we don't know much really about the convergence of equilibrium configuration. So this is the reason why basically in the talk that I'm going to give today, this parameter epsilon, the internal length will be fixed. It will be, let's say, equal to one, just for simplicity, because we don't know really how to manage completely. So there are only partial informations. There is a very, very important result, very recent important result, but still not at the point of using this for evolutions. Okay, now the energy that we have seen is non-convex. It is convex separately, which means that if you fix one of the two variables, it is convex in the other. It is even almost quadratic in the other energy, which is fine. It is not really quadratic because we have two different behaviors for positive and negative part, but anyway, it is not that is not that problem. Okay, so during the evolution, we will have a boundary condition on a part of the boundary. And let's say that we take a boundary condition of this time. So we fix a function g, and then we just increase time, okay, in a way that it is a monotonic floating as it is called. Now, for technical reason, the function, the boundary condition is to be in this solid space, but this is just a technical point. I don't care too much about this. So, of course, you see that the displacement is in H1, and then the phase field function is in H1, taking value in 0, 1. Okay. Actually, here you can even neglect this constraint because, for technical reasons, you can avoid it, but I will try to skip this detail throughout the talk. And then, what about equilibrium? Well, equilibrium for the displacement field is very, very simple. It is really just the derivative with respect to the admissible variations, nothing to say. But when we go to equilibrium with respect to the phase field, then we recover the equilibrium that we have seen at the very beginning, in the sense that there is just an inequality. Just an inequality because the admissible variations are not all the variation that you can have in H1, but are only negative variations. Okay, so equilibrium is once again an inequality. Fine. So here you see that I'm cheating a bit because I'm taking all the negative functions here, even if I do not take into account the constraint, but please let me skip on this point because it is just a detail that you can fix throughout the work. Now, let me say the following. So now, if we have an evolution, we do the following. We discretize time with a certain time step, we fix, of course, the initial condition, and then we do the following. Once you have the configuration at a certain time, you want to update to the new time here, okay, the new configuration. How do we do it? Well, there are a lot of ways to do it, and what we wanted here in this result was a sort of result which was taking into account all the possible ways of doing this without fixing the way you update. The point is that updating, you want a configuration here, which is an equilibrium configuration for the system. So this means that the two derivatives that we have seen before have to be equal to zero. Remember now the function here is partially differential because the two derivatives, they give you really the gradient, say, of the whole functional. But then since it is convex in the two directions, then this is basically equivalent to say that the new configuration u k plus one is minimizer given v, and that v is minimizer given u. Okay, so it is say a separate minimizer, it is called. We don't know whether it is a minimizer of the whole energy, because the point is that the energy is non-convex, so we could have convexity along one direction, convexity along another direction, but then we may have concavity in one of the other directions in between, and we will see that in example at some point where this happens. Okay, fine. So how do we find this new configuration in practice? Well, there are different ways. What is really common is to use energy descent algorithms. And there are really many. And I really don't want now to enter into the details. There are a lot of combination of schemes, but what is important that all these schemes, you know, they want to get an equilibrium configuration with this property and of course with the irreversibility constraint. Alternatively, you could use global minimizers of the energy, but you know, here you think that the energy is non-convex, so the global minimizer is maybe difficult to get, is maybe not the physical solution, not always the physical solution of the system. And so let's say that we stick somehow better with this kind of algorithms. The point is that the result works whatever you want if the new configuration is in equilibrium. Now, okay, one way to find the new configuration is to use what's called alternate minimization. This goes back really to one of the first papers on this method. And the idea is to minimize alternatively, first in the phase field variable, then the displacement, and then go on and you update. Of course, you know, you have a sort of sub-scheme, which is the scheme which is driving you from the previous in time to the next in time configuration. And in order to define really the new configuration, then you have to take the limit of this new sequence, which we have to compute up to sub-sequences, okay? Technically, we don't know whether all the sequences converging or not, okay? But this is just say, to give you an example of what happens and a way to compute this. Now, once you have an equilibrium configuration, basically we can write down the derivatives of the energy, and what happens is the following. So the derivative with respect to the displacement field is very simple, of course. It is this. This is the derivative with respect to the phase field. Again, we have an inequality. Admissible variations have just to take into account the constraint, of course. But then, since you can derive, say, back in time and forward in time, then you basically get this last condition, which will be very important here. So you get an inequality when you move in the direction of speed. So this is well known, I think, for obstacle problems. And now, of course, the point is take a linear interpolation in time and then pass to the limit. So it seems really easy. You get this and then you think, okay, now I will just pass to the limit now I will just pass to the limit here, but actually it is not really so easy. It is very complicated to compute the limit. And the point is that the system is rate independent, so there is no time regularity into the system to help you and find a way to pass to the limit and to characterize what happens. And also one of the other issues is the fact that so at the very beginning, we had two regimes. One was steady state and then another one was completely unsteady. And basically in time, it is as if you have a discontinuity and it gets really difficult to analyze the system from this point of view. So what we did was the following, to use a parameterized version. And basically the idea is this, okay? So you have the time steps here in the time interval, but then we just replace time step, let's say with a new parameterization in a new interval in a way that we get the following. So the parameterization will be say a function from S to t and then from t to v of t, of course, and we can do it in a way that the final composition is Lipschitz continuous in H1. Okay, this is a bit tricky, but then I will give you a detail on how to do it. Now, at this point, you may say, why this parameterization? Well, this parameterization is useful, it's very useful because of the following. So now we have for each time step this SK points, which correspond to time, which are basically related to the length of the evolution. Let's say the following. Let me look first at this example. Let's say that we go back to our example and we fix a certain time at which we take the picture, okay? And P It is this one, let's say the first time, and we get these points, which are the equilibrium configuration. So in this segment, I am drawing just, let's say, the angle between theta naught pi, corresponding in time to the configuration. Of course, you see that once you get to this point here, in time, then you will see a very long transition, which takes you to the final point here, to the final configuration. It's very long and always almost constant here, because the length of this segment is really the length of this segment here. Remember, there is no dynamics here, there is no rate dependence. So basically, when you refine time, all what happens is that you refine a lot only the first part of the evolution, because in the first part, you will see small variations compared to small variation in time. And then in the limit, as tau goes to zero, you will recover, say, here a line segment, which is of configurations, which correspond to this one. And then we see this part here, which is just, in some sense, FT up to the other point. Now, how can we sort of fix this from the general point of view is to use what is called the Kuratowski convergence of sets. Now, this is just a way to say understand it. I don't want to give you the definition of Kuratowski convergence, but the point is the following: that this discrete set of points is converging to a new set in the interval 0s, which is, let's say, here represented by this you see here. And the point is the following: that this limit s gives you exactly the set of points where the evolution is steady state. So looking at the system from this perspective of parametrization allows you to distinguish between steady state and unsteady evolution. And this makes things much easier, because then you know somehow the set where the evolution is steady state, and you can start studying what happens in the steady state configuration. Okay? Now, I don't want to show you that this is really the set of steady state configuration. Don't worry, but the point is that the idea of the parametrization is to split the two and characterize steady and unsteady configurations. Now, then there is another point which was very tricky, and this is the strong convergence of solutions. Now, I will show you maybe in the next slide about what happens in strong convergence of solutions. So you see that here, it is the sequence of the family of approximation depending on time, on the time step, and here is the limit. And you want to have it stronger from the beginning, otherwise it gets too complicated. Now, I want to show you maybe just this part here about the strong convergence, just to make you understand the following. So in this system, you have a sequence of obstacle problems. The obstacle is changing in time, but the obstacle itself is an unknown of the solution. We don't know how it is changing in time, because it is the configuration of the previous time step. And this makes the system a bit complicated, because convergence, strong convergence of solution of obstacle problems is known if you have strong convergence of the obstacle, which we don't here. So then proving that we have strong convergence gets very, very difficult. And this comes from basically a very complicated construction of energy competitors, which goes back in time in a way that you can compare. Let's say if this function decay is converging to V, you want to compare this part of the energy with this energy, the gradient of V, but you do it in two different sets, where decay is less than V here and where decay is larger than V. The point is that basically you can compare according to your constraint only here in this part of the energy, because if decay is a minimizer, then you can look to configuration which are lower, and you cannot do it here. And this is the tricky part, which really requires a construction in time, which takes into account the fact that we generated how to say, the obstacle according to the evolution. Okay? This is what somehow the point. Now, if we do it this way, then we get the following system in the limit in the parameterized setting S. Okay? So we get this, which is exactly the limit there. What happens out of the set S of steady state configurations? So this is the complementary set, so it is here. So the function D is affine and time is constant. So basically you have evolution, D, and D is affine just because of the interpolation, but time is constant. So this means that there is evolution even if there is no change in the boundary condition. And this is what gives you the idea of this unstable evolution, which happens when you push after the equilibrium configuration, which was unstable, and without time dependence, you will go instantaneously to the minimizer. Now, with this, then you can recover the energy balance. And let me just write you this final line here. You see that in the energy balance, you have two terms here. One is the power of external forces, which you expect, but the other one is another part here, which is somehow not expected. What is this? Well, this is just the energy that you lose when you start from this configuration and you fall down completely. So it is just a term which is concentrated on the set where the evolution is steady and completely unsteady, and it gives you the transition between one configuration and the other. Okay, this is how it is. Okay, this is in terms of PDE. I think I can skip this. Let me just say that at the end, you can reparametrize in time if you want going back. You have to be a little bit careful because we said that time is constant in a portion of our parametrization set. So when you invert it, there is no inverse, but you can define this sort of pseudo inverse, whatever. And basically it happens that when time is constant and then you invert, you will get an evolution for fixed time. And this is what happens exactly as a jump in time. Okay, let me just show you some numerics. I think now in the last part, I want to give you some numerics just to give you an idea. Now, this is the sample. There is a pre-existing crack here, and you are cooling on the two sides, here and here, okay? Above and below. In time, just in an increasing way. It is the sort of simplest example that you can make. This is called the double cantilever beam. So what you see here is this is almost the initial time, and this is the final time when the crack propagated throughout the domain, and this is an intermediate value. Okay, so we leave all of them with the free frame set. Okay, so this is just a nice plot, but let me show you what happens in terms of values of energy, evolution, energy release. This is important. Now, let me say, when you have this system, you can compare this phase speed setting with what is called the sharp crack set, which means that instead of using this phase speed approach, you just really introduce a discontinuity into the domain and then just split in two, okay? Just this is what is called the sharp, sharp model. Now, on the left here, we have the values of the elastic energy as a function of the crack elongation for phase feed and sharp crack. And you see that basically they coincide. You also see that the energy is, as a function of the crack elongation, is strictly convex, okay? Now, if we go here on the right, you see instead the evolution in time. What do I mean? So here we have time, and here you have crack elongation as a function of time. Of course, there is no motion until you reach a sort of critical level of stress. And then in this setting, which is done this way in a way that you get it, you see a sort of a linear evolution here. But you see that the two, they almost coincide. So sharp crack and phase feed, they are really almost coinciding. Now, let me tell you, oh, of course, when I say length, I mean really the physical length of the crack, if it is just approximated, just opening the domain, changing the domain. If I am in phase speed, I just mean that I compute the length given the phase speed function, which I computed by Yartal normalization. Now, there is one point here. So you see, we saw that there are two regimes, stable and unstable. In this setting, all the evolution is stable. It is, of course, stable here. There is no evolution, and it is stable here. So here I am just plotting the function V, then you can plot also the displacement. Now, This is due to the fact that at the end, the energy is strictly convex as a function of crack elongation. So thanks to this, we have this very stable evolution. Now, the point changes completely once you load in this other way. So along this and this edge, this is called the single edge notch under tension. Now, things become completely different in this sense. So look at the energy. So still the energy is very well approximated. So sharp energy and phase field energy are very well approximated. Of course, here the internal length is very small in order to get this, but we expect it by gamma convergence. But you see now, I don't know whether you can see it clearly, but now this is no longer convex. And this is actually slightly concave. Slightly, not much, but slightly concave. Now let's look at the evolution. Now, in this case, since this energy is a function of crack elongation is almost concave, we will be in the other setting where we will be completely unstable. In which sense? Okay, look at this. This is the blue line. Is the sharp evolution, so there will be no evolution of the crack up to this point. It means that you need to load a bit, but then at that point, you will be immediately unstable, okay, as if you are really on the edge of the falling block of wood, and then you will jump up instantaneously to the global minimizer here, which is what corresponds to the block, say, laying down. But now the point is the following. Now let's see what happens if we use phase field with the alternate minimization algorithm. So minimizing separately in the two variables, you see the following. So there is no evolution up to a time, which is actually this one, like 1.5 or even before, and then a slight evolution start. Actually, in this small branch, there is not really an advance of the crack, but only a very, very small portion of phase field, which is at the tip of the crack appearing. And then you see again, all of a sudden, you jump up. And then again, there is a little bit of, say, evolution, even if you won't expect it, but it is just because of numerical errors. Okay, we tried a lot to reduce the gap between the two, because we are not expecting to see any gap. And the point is the following. The point is that this gap can be reduced, but not if you look only at first order derivatives. You need to look at second order derivatives of the energy. What is the point? Guess the following. You have an energy which is convex in one direction, zero derivative, convex into the other, zero derivative. But then in between the two, there will be a direction where the energy is decreasing. We don't know when it happens, but it can happen. And this is exactly what happens here. If you look at second derivatives and the scheme which was devised by Leon Baldelli and Maurini, basically is done in this way. You look at second derivatives of the energy, you look at all the eigenvalues, you look at the lowest eigenvalue, which is negative, then you find the eigenfunction, which gives you the direction of propagation, and then you look in that direction to see what you can get, okay? Somehow, okay, just to fix the ideas. But of course, this is very heavy. So this is just to say that basically, equilibrium, okay, is fine, is what everyone is doing, but still, it could be that there are different evolutions still with equilibrium, okay? So it's sort of non-uniqueness of the evolution, in some sense, if you look only at equilibrium configuration. Okay, let me show you the following now. As I told you, we perform this scheme, which is alternate minimization, so first minimizing displacement and then in phase field. And what happens is the following. Look, if this is a point where the evolution is continuous, then you do really a few iterations and you are already below the threshold, which is, say, the stopping criterion, which is very strict, but still it is enough. What happens instead if you are in a point of discontinuity? It happens the following. Basically, at the very beginning, I will give another example which is even better. So, sorry, what is plotted here is just the length of the increment, okay, in a norm, which I think is either at infinity or H1. But you see that basically there is a very, very long transition here where all the steps are almost constant. And then there is a spike up and then going down. Of course, when it gets down here, then it will be so small that it will stop. But you see that basically There is a sort of non-monotone behavior like this, which I can explain in this way. Guess you are in one configuration, which is flat, and then the energy becomes concave after, something like this, okay? So when you are here, the derivative will be proportional to the slope, so it will be very, very small at the beginning. Then if this tail is very long, you will see this very long number of steps where the length is fine. And then for some reason here, it seems that then it becomes higher, but you know, it is most probably because of this. So this is a positive part, it does something like this, or it goes down something like this, but still with negative derivative, and you get this. Indeed, if you then plot, and this example is maybe better, you see very well here that there is this behavior, it's very small, it goes up again, and then again you see this drop in energy here, which is 0.5. Now, you see that there are here a lot of oscillations. They were not in the previous example. These oscillations are due to remeshing. In some cases, we use a lot of remeshing. And some people say, well, but you know, you remesh and you change the problem, you don't know exactly what happens. But still, if you look at the values of the energies, apart from these spikes here, which correspond to these very long steps here, so the energy is always decreasing, okay? Sorry, the total energy up, the yellow one, is always decreasing. So even if we are remeshing, there is no, I mean, it is a sort of safe remeshing, because if you remesh, you can change the problem, you could get stuck, but it doesn't happen. So remeshing is controlled in a way that we don't see it apart from these few points. And so the behavior of the energy is still fine. Now, I want to tell you somehow why we see this very nice consistency between sharp crack and phase split, and go a little bit deeper into this, because we said that there is gamma convergence, it is fine, but the evolution is not really driven by gamma convergence. The evolution is driven by derivatives of the energy, and we still don't know much about derivative of the energy. So we wanted to have a look a little bit better. So, first of all, let me say the following. If V is an equilibrium configuration, then the derivative of the length with respect to any possible variation is non-negative, which is fine. It means that all variations are, say, thermodynamically consistent with the constraint. Fine. And then in order to find to understand the consistency, so here I am a little bit more technical in some sense. For those who know a little bit better, we need to define what is called the energy release of the system. And basically, here I am defining the energy release in this way. So you take all the derivative of the elastic energy computed in the elastic minimizer with respect to any possible variations, but normalized in length, okay? So it works like a norm. If you want to define the norm of a functional, which is, say, a linear functional like this, then you should normalize here with some norm. Okay, this is what we find in the dual. Here we don't have really a norm to work with, but we have a notion of length, and we need to normalize with respect to the length, okay? So guess that you want to compute the gradient of a functional, either you compute the gradient in some way, or you can define as the sup of the derivative of the gradient versus all the unitary vectors, okay? This is somehow the same, but we don't have really a norm, okay? It is not really the only way. And then it happens the following, that once you have this, then you recover basically Griffith criterion, which is the criterion which is used in sharp crack for the evolution. We don't recover the criterion really everywhere, but let's say almost everywhere in time, which means that we don't get the criterion in unstable branches, basically. So you see, you get the usually Karsh contact conditions. The G is less than GC, G minus GC time L dot is equal to zero, which is Griffith criterion. But then we get also more. We get what is called the G max criterion. The point is the following now. When this is purely scalar, okay? Because this you see is a sup and this is a constant. So this is purely scalar. But When you have a fracture which is moving, whatever the way into the domain, because I show you just very simple examples, you have somehow to add a criterion which tells you what is the direction taken by the crack. There are several, but this method here, which is driven in this way by this stable, sorry, by this equilibrium configuration, satisfies what is called the Gmax criterion, which means that G here, we see, which is the sum of all the possible derivatives, is attained when psi is the normalized velocity. Okay, so this says that the system is evolving in the direction where the derivative of this energy, only the elastic energy, is steepest. Okay, so not really the whole energy, but the elastic energy. And then we have what I told you at the very beginning, this thermodynamical consistency of the constraint with respect to the dissipation. So we know that dissipation is always increasing, which you don't have in general at the beginning. You need to prove it in this model. Okay, fine. I don't want to enter into detail on what happens in unstable points because it's a bit tricky. And I want to take the last minutes to show you something more, which we did for fun in some sense. Okay. So at some point, I was working on networks of cracks in paintings. This is, I mean, it's well known and studied by people doing renovations and studying the mechanics of paintings. And somehow the problem is the following, that you have either the frame, or the canvas itself changes in time because of changing in temperature and humidity. And this changing, then they produce changes on the paint layer. And one of the not nice effects is that the paint layer breaks into many pieces, still attached to the canvas, but it breaks. Now, this is a painting which I bought. Then I will tell you the story later. It is in my office here. This is what happens at the corner. So this is a network of corner cracks. There are these big cracks in this direction, and then these other cracks going from the point here up, you see, somehow. Okay. Now, this is the zoom which I took with my camera. What you see here, colors are different just to highlight the presence of cracks. Okay, this is so it is exactly the same. And this is the simulation which I got, which somehow resembles, of course, geometrically, because there is a lot of optimality in our model. I mean, here there are a lot of uncertainties that you see, but you see really that you get these cracks appearing here and then the other longitudinal cracks. Now, what is nice is that in the evolution, first you see these cracks going, let's say, southeast, and which then give you this larger deformation here. And then there is a second generation of crack which goes into the other direction, and these are smaller. At the very beginning, I was upset when I saw this because I was expecting these cracks to move somehow in this direction, crossing not orthogonally, but they actually cannot because, I mean, it's a condition of optimality in the function of the cracks they have to meet. If a crack is already there, you have to meet at 90 degrees. There is no way. You must get a T-junction. But then when I was looking with the camera and was zooming a lot, I saw that indeed it is not always so. So here in this point, I'm sorry that I have to point with my finger, you see that it is starting here, but then getting to this point. Even here, it is not really exactly starting at the same point. And even here, if you look carefully, it is not really crossing. It is almost crossing there. Okay? And the point is that almost all these cracks are unstable. So they appear really sort of instantaneously. So at some point, the network develops almost instantaneously everywhere. Now, what is the model here? It is exactly the same functional that we have seen before, but now instead of the boundary condition, we have a term here which is taking into account the effect of gluing the layer U. U gives the deformation of the layer with the canvas below. So the canvas moves, and as the canvas moves, the layer breaks. Okay. Now let me show you in this painting. This is very interesting because the network is very, very fine. You see, there are a lot of cracks here. The fact that they are aligned in this way is due to the alignment of the canvas. The canvas is, say, aligned this way, and the size of the canvas is influencing a lot this. Look, this is a detail, I think, of this part here, but I'm not sure. Yes, I think of this part here. So you see, it's quite clear, you have vertical and horizontal. Then I was running simulation, and of course, it is only a local simulation because bigger is impossible, it takes too much time. And this is what you get here. First, you see you get these two vertical cracks, which are straight, and then you get the horizontal one. And once again, the horizontal are not crossing perfectly, but you see that somehow also here it happens that the horizontal one are not crossing perfectly. Okay, so this gives you the idea that first vertical cracks and then horizontal cracks appear. But then there is this very strange behavior here where you don't see the T junctions, you see the triple junction. What is the point? The point is the following. These two cracks, vertical and horizontal, they appear at the same time for some reason, which is related to the size of this rectangle here, which remains. So somehow once you break, it is as if you split into two rectangles, and the size of this rectangle here, actually the size was a bit larger, but this I'm zooming only, was done in such a way that basically the two cracks appear at the same time. At this point, the configuration completely changes, and instead of getting T junctions, you get two triple junctions. But what is nice is that if you have a look at what happens there, you see two triple junctions again. And here as well, you see two triple junctions. So this again gives you the idea that depending on the size, it could be that they appear all of a sudden and they get this. This is to show you just how remeshing is working. It is this is the remeshing of this part of the domain. Okay, you see that basically the mesh is going and following the phase field function and during the evolution, and this is what you get as a final result. Now, about triple junctions again, and then I almost finished. Now, the geometry is incredibly sensitive to parameters. I mean, not only the system is very unstable, I mean, that as you change a little bit the configuration, then all the system, I mean, you get a full network of cracks, but also the dependent on parameters. Look, the parameter beta is just the guy that you have here in front, okay? It's just this guy here. So here there is this function, but it is maybe more a detail. So if you change from this value, to this value, this is what you get as the final configuration of the system. I mean, it's still a matter of triple junctions because they appear all of a sudden. Here, the deformation is purely volumetric, okay? So it is just enlarging in this way, but the configuration is completely different. This is really just to give you an idea of maybe even also how many different configurations you may get, because in the domain, you cannot expect to have parameters constant in a painting because it is so different, and this gives you a completely different configuration. But then, you know, once again, this structure is known, and this maybe is not so nice. This looks much, much closer to this kind of geometries. And oops, I'm sorry, I made a mistake once again. This is actually on the wall of my bedroom at home, and was the result of some water falling down from the air conditioning system. Some water was falling down on the wall, and then due to drying of the wall later, these cracks appear. And indeed, this is something which happens a lot. Drying material, you know, in the ground, it gives the effect is to break into small portions. Okay, the optimal is somehow by these hexagonal shapes. You can imagine, okay, somehow the hexagonal shape. And what I found nice here when I was working on this was the following: that this pattern of hexagonal shapes, indeed, was used in this paper, which was quite famous at the moment, to justify the presence of water on Mars. Because on Mars, they took this picture, and with some image processing, they found out that there were some sort of edges with this hexagonal structure. Okay? And this hexagonal structure means the following, that there was some water, and then at some point this water was evaporating, or if it's not water, it was something liquid, but still then it was evaporating. During the drying process of the ground, it was breaking in this way with this pattern like this. Okay? And with this, I think I can conclude. Thank you.